warm faces and not frozen feet. I welcome you all to the lecture by Dr. Claudia Schicker. This lecture originated as an idea to bring a time witness to my German 271 class. We're talking in this class about youth media in the German Democratic Republic. We have movies and we have songs and books and all the traditional texts that you can imagine. But we also had books with time witnesses in it. And my mother, Dr. Claudia Schicker, our last name, she is a time witness. And I thought it would be great because she wanted to come here to spend some time with me, and I thought she needs to spend some time with you to tell you more about how she experienced literature in the German Democratic Republic. In 1975, she was a student in the EOS, which is a secondary school of the higher degree where you go on to university, in Wernigerode, still my hometown. And she was in a school that focused on music. So later on, she moved to Halle to study music in German. And she had already sung in the world-renowned choir that he would have had in that school, the youth radio choir, so that music was one part to get involved more with that. She received her PhD in 85 with a dissertation about regime critical literature in the 1970s in the German Democratic Republic, and the same year she became head of the county library in Wernigerode. 2 years later, she became head of the Klub of the Intelligentsia, Klub der Intelligenz, in the Cultural Association of the GDR. And after the fall of the wall in 89, she started a new job. And she became a teacher at a local secondary school, first teaching German and music, but then acquiring a few more degrees. Between 98 and 2001, she completed her first state exam, so the West version of the East German Diploma for Teachers in philosophy. And she received a teaching certificate in economy in 2014. So this allowed her to add ethics, economy, and social studies to her curriculum. She also taught philosophy didactics between 2002 and 2006 at the Otto von Guericke Universität in Magdeburg. So you can see she's a busy bee. I'm really happy that you're all here. We have some Sanola representatives as well, which makes me really happy, and some alums, some other people connected, to hear her talk about the ideals of communism, the realities of socialism, and the limits of the German Democratic Republic.
Thank you.
It's very nice to be here. I usually don't speak English because it was difficult to learn it in East Germany, but today I will try my best. In the fall of 1989, no one in Germany would have thought, not even in their dreams, that 1 year later only one Germany would exist, that they could be citizens of West Germany, and that they would buy their groceries with a West German mark. Unlike in the year 1949, when the German Democratic Republic was founded. The GDR writer Johannes Erbecher, for example, was the founder of the All-German Kulturbund, the culture association of the GDR. Later, Becher became the first GDR minister for culture. In the text of the GDR national anthem, he wrote of Germany as a united fatherland. Hans Eisler composed a melody for it. One could have easily sung Becher's text to the melody of the West German national anthem, and vice versa, no problem. But the occupying force had very different ideas about the political and economic system of the German zones. They built the Iron Curtain to both Germanies. In 1972, the dream of United Fatherland was definitely over. The text of the anthem was not sung anymore. It was forbidden to sing the text. Only the melody by Eisler was played in its orchestral version. Since I was a child, I have lived in a small town called Wernigerode. I was 29 years old in 1989 and married. We had a 7-year-old daughter and a 2-year-old son. We lived in a small, and we had a good life there. West Germany was only a few kilometers away. We were able to get West German channels on our TV. We had two programs. We watched commercials, the news, and Hollywood movies. And we were so occupied with GDR everyday life that we would have never thought of illegal escape. The Culture Association was a state-approved umbrella organization for all clubs and interest groups in the GDR. There were stamp and coin collectors, friends of the homeland, the fishing keeping group, and many more. This way, the GDR government had formed a niche, which it was able to control. The intellectual clubs also belonged to it. They offered room for discussion to intellectuals and art fans. My husband and I each earned almost 1,000 GDR marks a month. A shift worker who worked on the production line was paid more money. Still today, I think it was fair that those people in the GDR who did hard physical work from an early age on and who supported with their tax money those who went to college, that these workers were paid higher wages. In September 1989, a famous economic historian and writer finally came to Wernigerode to give a book reading in our Kulturbund, Jürgen Kuczynski. In 1983-84, his book, Dialogue with My Great-Grandson, a book which criticized the GDR reality, was published. And the special thing about it, Kuczynski was an old communist. Someone who had helped build socialism in the GDR in the country's earliest days. He came from a bourgeois home. He was a smart and critical thinker. He maintained a balance between receiving honorary medals from the state and being punished by the party for his criticism. But the fact that he was courted by the published institution of the government showed us that he was, after all, a favorite of Erich Honecker. But Konrad Naumann, a prominent member of the government, said that Kuczynski's book was the most critical book that ever published about the GDR. Erich Honecker, a rather small-minded person, had made sure with the help of Soviet party comrades that the GDR state got rid of Walter Ulbricht, the party chief before him. Then Honecker started ruling the country after the year 1971 as the head of Socialist Unity Party, the SED, the ruling party. After 1973, after Ulbricht's death, Honecker became the chairman of the state. Honecker reigned like Louis XIV of France. He was patronizing and despotic. He liked to decorate himself with a company of artists and historians, and with politicians from the Western world. He tampered with everything, even things that he didn't know at all. So this way, the GDR experienced only seemingly a liberalization of the cultural sector. As long as an artist upheld socialist ideals, he or she was allowed to voice criticism in his works. But Honecker showed his true temper and despotism when his own position was in danger. The exploration of the critical singer and songwriter with Biermann and the state security prisons are only two examples. Totally aloof, Honecker lived close to Berlin with the rest of the government in a sealed-off little town called Wandlitz. There you could find all your heart desired. And because his underlings did not want to lose the affection of their head of state, they forged economical records and did everything so that the real status quo of the country would not be known to their leaders. Because of this, when Honecker visited ailing cities, shiny posters were hung in front of dilapidated houses, or in order to show that the economic plan for housing projects had been fulfilled, they simply built only the external facade of the houses. Then the official visitors drive by happy and content waving to the residents. And Jürgen Kuczynski criticized exactly this actually existing socialism in the GDR, and his book was actually printed. Kuczynski denounced the defects in politics, economy and cultural policy in the GDR. He took a stand on the times of Joseph Stalin. He considered the GDR government to be almost feudally, absolutistic, bureaucratic. He criticized the lack of problem awareness as missing grassroots democracy and the existing whitewashing and self-importance of the politicians. At the same time, however, he almost sang hymns of praise about socialism itself. In order to find Kuczynski's criticism, a reader often has to search between the lines. But you can immediately see the hymns of praise. When I prepared to talk for today, I reread Kuczynski's book again. Today, I find it totally harmless. Back then, it was a cult book. Our instincts in the GDR were significantly more refined when it came to critical undertones. But we didn't know back then that Kuczynski had already written his book 12 years earlier, and that Honecker had originally forbidden the publication. We also didn't know that Kuczynski had diffused some of the critical passages in an act of self-censorship. In the early 80s, Kuczynski had announced that he would not celebrate his own 80th birthday together with Honecker in a prestigious state enactment if the book would stay unpublished. Honecker was impressed by that and approved. We did not know that either. GDR books were a tricky endeavor. The party press published reviews about new publication. For example, in daily newspaper New German. If that review was overly favorable, it wasn't really worth buying the book. But a scathing review, maybe the message was not optimistic enough, the book's hero had character flaws, or the plot was about some isolated case, that didn't pertain to the entire system. If such negative reviews was found in a newspaper, then you had to go to the bookstore immediately. As a regular customer, you were then able to buy this so-called Bückware, literally bent down goods, where only very few copies were lying under the counter for interested readers. It was not a question of money, whether one was able to get a certain book or not. Today, you would pay a lot to buy a rare article on eBay. But in the GDR, it was a question of connections with the bookseller, because the state determined the prices. But how did a writer receive a printing permission in the GDR? Was there a governmental censorship? Here too, the government covered things up and tricked people. The public authorities changed nothing in a book. It was always the writer, him or herself. Today, these writers could possibly accuse themselves, I was not steadfast enough. I could have been a martyr and possibly prevented the system to exist for so long. So the writer has the idea for a book. He may want, for example, to write about the bureaucracy in the country, about dogmatism of party officials, or the lack of grassroots democracy. He talks with friends, party comrades, and his or her spouse about his plan. You can read about that in the diaries of writers such as Erwin Strittmatter or Christa Wolf. I know about that because of my great friend, Yuri Koch. Friends and family warn the writer. The criticism might be too obvious. The book could not be published that way. The work may be for nothing. The writers would endanger themselves of losing their privileges. Could be exploited by the West for the Cold War, to be considered an enemy of the state, and especially to jeopardize the membership in the Writers' Association. Worst case scenario, they could lose their job. The Writers Association took care of their members. It offered educational opportunities in the Literature Institute, trainings, education and vacation trips into the socialist, what was a capitalist world, kindergarten sports, help finding housing, help finding cars, and work supplies. It helped with public relations, scholarships, and commission work. But above all, it provided each writer with a social security number. Only with that number, a writer was able to publish with a publishing company. This way, there was enough pressure on each member. Therefore, the Writers Association was also an institution that disciplined people. It demanded of every writer that he or she would only write in the style of socialist realism, which respected the leading role of the working class under the guidance of the Socialist Unity Party. They expected that every writer publicly declared their attitude towards socialism and to sign off on political resolutions according to what the party wanted. These resolutions and the signatures could then be found in newspapers. Writers were forced to accept political functions, which then politically supported the party. Only very few writers were so famous and indispensable for the government that they were able to invade that pressure. Every writer now asks him or herself, is this stress worth it? Can't I do this differently? And they try to maneuver, to carefully hide their criticism in metaphors. That's how self-censorship works. The finished manuscript is then sent to the Office of Literature and Publishing, the pre-censorship institution. Editors, chief editors, and publishing managers are also dependent on the party. They could lose their jobs or their privileges, and especially there's also important connections. They appeal, they argue, they ask for revisions, the second step of self-censorship. The next office is the Ministry of Culture. Several experts decide. If they are unsure, they protect themselves by involving the Department of Culture in the Central Committee of the Socialist Unity Party. Finally, the manuscript reached Kurt Hagen, the head of the Ideological Commission. The book manuscript has come so far already. Why not fail at this last obstacle? Now the third adjustment was requested. The writer always had to agree with any changes. So third step in self-censorship. This way, the writer was forced to change everything himself. He turned into an opportunist, he adapted, he could have simply refused. But at this time in the GDR, there was no way to reach the masses through another channel. There were no copy machines, no internet, no private radio or TV. As soon as the manuscript received the long desired stamp of approval for printing, it went back to the publisher. Paper shortage, missing printing or book binding capacities further delay the publication. Then the book gets printed. Critical books only in limited edition. And then, suddenly, the direction of party politics changed. Before Gorbachev came to power in the Soviet Union, party politics in the GDR were always influenced by the Soviet Union. Then the book may be forbidden and gets turned into paper waste after all. Kuczynski's book almost took 7 years to be published, and it actually did make it to the bookstores. In 1989, Kuczynski had already organized readings and discussions tables for almost 5 years, supported by the Politburo of the SED. First in the capital Berlin, then in district cities, after that in smaller towns. In the meantime, the GDR was a boiling pot of political unrests. On TV, we watched fleeing GDR citizens immigrate through Hungary. Most of the people that we knew left because of economic reasons, or because they had relatives in West Germany, because they saw how well off those were. These relatives sent holiday greetings from Mallorca or the Canary Island, always wearing the newest fashion and eating tropical fruits. Relatives that for years have sent so-called vest packages to the East with chocolate, jeans, felted pants, coffee, cigarettes. All products that we couldn't buy in the GDR or that were too expensive. With Westmark, they were able to buy things in intershops. The things they didn't need, they simply sold in second-hand stores. These West relatives never spoke about unemployment, the dog-eat-dog society, the personal problems. And those Easterners who received West packages wanted to leave the GDR. They were better off than we were. That's how we saw it, anyways, back then. My family did not have any relatives in West Germany, but we also didn't think that we were missing out on something existential. We enjoyed our job. We traveled to Hungary, the Czech Republic, and Poland for vacation. And there were so many more interesting countries in the East that I wanted to see. The United States, England, France, they strangely did not awaken my desire. Maybe it was because the realities of these countries were not a topic in the GDR. My parents raised me to be a lawyer towards the state, to be a true child in the GDR. We did not doubt the concept of socialism per se. My father was a professional soldier in the Wehrmacht, the armed forces of Germany in the 1930s. This was his only possibility to escape unemployment at the beginning of the 1930s. My mother worked as a children's nurse during that time. Actually, she wanted to go to London as an au pair, but England was at war with Germany. Both my father and my mother have experienced the war firsthand. Stalingrad, buried under bomb debris in Berlin. They simply wanted to live in peace. Politics were unimportant to them. They ended up in the Soviet occupation zone. They adapted, had two children, took care of their old parents, withdrew into privacy, and they mastered everyday life. We didn't know about any state security jails. With me as their daughter-in-law, the family of my husband did not talk about the fact that their great-grandfather had been in Bautzen for 6 years, a place where the GDR had their political prisoners. He suffered severe consequences from this imprisonment. All that was the past, a past that was unprocessed. My in-law were leaders in the free German youth and music teachers. Their youngest son had a career in the National People's Army in the GDR. They didn't want to endanger his future, and they couldn't change the past. Here too, they got comfortable in their own house. Every year, they spent 3 weeks at the Baltic Sea. Scrambled eggs and caviar, sparkling wine, the canned pineapples from the delicatessen store. I had to organize the reading with Kuczynski and the Kulturgut. And here, I experienced for the first time that one of the official employees of the state security, the Stasi, Dr. Meyer, came to the Kulturbund in person. I had often met him at meetings before. He wanted to plan the details of the event with me. The audience should only receive tickets if they entered their name beforehand into a list. Here, I was supposed to watch out that no agitators from alternative unofficial groups and state enemies would come. I thought he can totally have such a list. Names were on it. The Kulturbund had enough members, the telephone book had enough citizens in Wernigerode. No one would check IDs before the reading or cross-check the tickets with the names. Of course, I sold tickets to anyone who wanted to come. There were so many people that we had to plan 2 events. I don't really take any of this politically, but more as tech tactical fun to play a trick and an old dogmatic party member and Stasi quick. Already at an early discussion about the youth protest in China at the Peace Square that went down in history at the June 4th massacre, I had provoked him so much that he threw a temper tantrum because I did not support the official party line. When faced with Stalinist methods, one-sided black and white depictions of events, and uncritical thinking, I'm always pressed to my full potential. Still today. This unpleasant, choleric man, Dr. Meyer, was a bureaucrat and dogmatist in the hick town of Wernigerode. There, everyone was hypocritically living in an apathy. People desperately tried to build connection with party members in order to enjoy more privileges. Only in the security of their own home or in the tiny workers' team, they were ranting about defects of the system without actually wanting to do anything against them. Those people, I thought, were to blame for the misery of socialism in Virginia. No one wanted to say too much, like my mother always pointed out. But I have always said what I thought, and never really any personal disadvantages. Maybe because the government at that time had more trouble with real dissidents and state enemies, and I alone wasn't really a danger for the GDR. The Stasi employed Dr. Meyer now determined which questions I was supposed to allow during the Kuczynski reading, and which question I was supposed to stop. I was supposed to stop anything. He would have to do that himself, really. And this way, all critical questions about the system were actually asked and Kuczynski answered them in detail. The audience was debating actively with his old communist. He explained that the GDR was departing more and more from the socialist ideal, that Honecker needed to be replaced, and that the young party members who knew about the problems and wanted to get rid of them would already be ready to go. That the biggest problem in our country was actually the covering up of economic and social problems. The politicians had long removed themselves from the common people and they now lived in a dream world. And that the time had finally come to include the GDR citizens in political decisions and to consider them as a major partner in change. From today's view, that was harmless criticism. Such things could surely be read in a daily newspaper of any democratic country. But in the GDR, we didn't have a free press, no fourth power, like we have in a democracy that could have revealed shortcomings. That's why we needed those critical works by writers and especially discussions about them. The GDR government supported the Kulturbund as a niche to allow discussion in small groups. Then the Stasi monitored them. The intellectual clubs in particular were considered to be meeting spot for the Intelligentsia and those people who thought they belonged there. Usually, the clubs were housed in prestigious mansions, so that the atmosphere was full of culture as well. During the events, they served drinks and snacks, and if a club leader had good connection to the Stasi or the party leadership, they were able to get some bell peppers, orange, cucumbers, pineapples that they could offer their distinguished guests. The official employees of the Stasi went in and out of the Kulturbund, and everyone knew them. They also had unofficial employees. I would get to know them during the reading with Kuczynski for the first time face to face. Some of the gentlemen who did not buy tickets from me that evening wanted to gain access to the reading. I told them they could not enter because the event was sold out. The only possibility to listen to Kuczynski would be standing room in the backyard outside. In front of the open windows, where already 20 other people had gathered. This irritated the man. Dr. Meyer saved them. They were allowed to enter the room together with him. He had some extra chairs brought to the last row where they sat down. Because I argued so loudly with them before, everyone else in the room knew now who these guys were. But in 1989, no one really cared about that anymore. The audience asked everything, forbidden questions as well, and Kuczynski didn't hold back. It is interesting that shortly before the reunification in Germany in 1919, most of the intellectuals, also of members of new oppositional groups, such as the New Form or Democracy Now, did not really want an annexation of the GDR into the capitalist West. They did not want a market economy with unemployment or poverty. No society that favored prosperity and threw away culture that destroyed the environment. They did not want to exploit the developing countries in order to enjoy cheap bananas or coffee. They wanted a liberal, democratic, and socialist GDR. I know today that these ideas of 1989 were naive. Because of the high debt burden of the GDR and simple logistic and economic considerations. The ordinary person of the street saw all of this quite differently. The call for the West German mark was also a call for freedom of consumption and materialistic wealth. Today, some of these former East Germans call for an all-around welfare state that provides them with jobs, with free healthcare if possible, that condemns all entrepreneurs as exploiters who should pay very high taxes so that we can increase welfare for everyone. This social security is already so high today that a common job assistant who is actually working has less money left at the end of the month than those who receive welfare. For the majority of former East Germans who were used to a paternalistic state, it is difficult to show community spirit and especially personal initiative in today's civil society. The political turn in the GDR was therefore not really brought forth by artists, but by the people who were materialistic and satisfied. The communist writer Bertolt Brecht already realized that the material needs of the people would have to be satisfied first. Everyone had to be fed before he would start thinking critically. Only then would he be ready to use human reasoning to become a better person. It only became apparent after the annexation of the GDR into West Germany that the fulfillment of materialistic needs could be a barrel without a bottom. Because the market keeps causing new needs and people can never get enough when compared to other people. And what is interesting about this is, in 1989, it would have been possible for the first time to take a third path in the GDR's political development, without any influence from the Soviet Union. 40 years before, after the Second World War, the occupational forces determined the political makeup of Germany. Now, Gorbachev offered the socialist countries in Europe a level of authority that they had never had before. But it became apparent that the idea of planned economy did not work that way. According to Adam Smith, people work most effectively when guided by selfish reasons. And that's why it went so completely wrong for the GDR after 1945. After the end of the Second World War, those writers came back first to the Soviet occupation zone, who had been in exile in those countries that had taken in communism and socialism. Anna Segers, for example, was in Mexico, Johannes Elbecher in Moscow, Kuczynski in London. Many bourgeois intellectuals stayed in their country of exile, waiting to see how the situation in occupied Germany would develop. Some never returned, because they managed to become citizens of the new country in the meantime, or they were so famous that Switzerland took them or the committed suicide out of desperation. That's why it was completely understandable that those communist and socialist democratic artists were only able to imagine themselves in a socialist alternative to capitalism and imperialism after the experience during the war and in exile. In the Soviet Union, Stalin had implemented the theory of Karl Marx and Friedrich Engels that used criticism of capitalism as its basis. Its manifest was the longed for world revolution, and its practical continuation was the October Revolution with Lenin. This theory was supposed to be transferred to East Germany. Dear Daddy Stalin was worshipped. Image of happy people in booming regions in the Soviet Union motivated people in East Germany to build socialism according to the Soviet model. Only select people were allowed to see this particular socialism on trips to the Soviet Union. Power to the people. Making production socialists means no exploitation and profit-seeking culture. It means to build a community of citizens that feels responsible for one another and who work together to reach a peaceful society, in which everyone has a job, a home, and can fulfill their existential needs. The dictatorship of the working class as state leadership was supposed to reign as long as the basics of this utopian-like lifestyle were fulfilled. But the world revolution did not start in all the countries at the same time. The people in the capitalist world experienced an economic miracle after the Second World War. The people in the GDR had economic shortage because the cost of defense to rearm the country in the Cold War ate up any profits the GDR economy made. One had to spend foreign money to buy natural resources. The Soviet people suffered and were starving for a world revolution. And in the GDR, we would have had riots much earlier if those Western relatives hadn't sent care package to their poor brothers and sisters. The artists in the GDR did not really push against the socialism until the 1980s. We can see that with the writers. There was the older generation that had come back from exile, the anti-fascists and communists of the very first day. They were prosecuted by the Hitler regime. Their books were burned in 1933. They were role models. Among them, there were idealists such as Bertolt Brecht, bourgeois anti-fascists such as Stefan Hermlin, who embellished their biographies a little bit, and the Stalinists and dogmatists such as Willy Bredel and Otto Gottschalk. These writers accompanied the GDR people with their books during the construction period of the GDR. Hardships and setbacks were accepted to support socialism. They saw their role as teachers of the people and idols. The generation after them often suffered from inferiority complexes because of these older heroes. Representatives of this younger generation had spent their childhood and youth in Nazi Germany. They did their military service in the Second World War. Among them were Erwin Schrittmatter and Franz Fühmann. Some were exposed to Nazi propaganda in school, such as Christa Wolf and Ulrich Plansdorf. Equipped with this feeling of guilt, they wanted to help with the construction of socialism. They lived inside an actually existent socialism, but they realized that they lived in a dictatorship. That was a contradiction between ideal and reality. They saw themselves in the role of those who would enlighten everyone and, at the same time, as those who would criticize the system. They wanted to challenge taboos, but they also suffered from self-doubt and they were afraid to lose their privileges. Some of them still held on to the ideal of socialism, for example, Christa Wolf. And they wrote to counter the mistakes that were made in the realization of these ideals. Others lost the illusion. For example, Erwin Strittmatter, who realized that Marxism indeed offered a good analysis of capitalist economy, but it could never be an ideal society. It had instead turned into some form of religion. That means faith, hope, but it also meant clinging to dogmas. These writers tried to diplomatically escape party functions and they adapted. And then there were those writers who lost their working basis because of governmental censorship of their works. They did not want to change. And they emigrated to West Germany, for example, Rainer Kunze and Günter Konrad. But the influence of the youngest generation, the alternative writers of the 1980s, was not a big on the common citizen, as one can often read in secondary literature. These writers and songwriters saw the weaknesses of the system, but they didn't have a concrete political vision. They wanted an implementation of human rights, free speech, and the freedom to travel. But they often lived so alternative that the capitalist world was not an option either. They organized themselves, for example, in the Prenzlauer Berg scene or the peace movement. Their works were not able to become effective for the masses because the publishers did not print them and the editions of handwritten papers were limited. The interested reader in Bernardo Rode did not know critical writers such as Uwe Kolber or Lutz Rathenow. It is hard to imagine a reality where one is cut off from current events if those were not published by the government. Only privileged people, party officials, doctors, and those who had connections had access to telephone landline. There were no copy machines, really. Just an office and schools where one had to record each and every copy made. My boyfriend at the time owned some handwritten lyrics by the regime critical singer and songwriter Wolf Biermann. I hid them for him in the closet of my boarding school room. When the Western radio broadcast introduced, for example, Orwell's book 1984, we sat in front of the radio and recorded the whole thing with a cassette player. We listened to the recording so many times that we were able to copy down the whole text. Then we copied that text with a typewriter. Were we able to make three different copies again? It was hard work to spread new ideas in the DDR. It was quite difficult to start a revolution. Thank you.
Questions and let's do Danglish. My mother would appreciate German, but if we do English, we help out each other.
Ja, ich würde gerne wissen, Sie haben ja Ihre Dissertation über Dissidenten in der Literatur. Wie wurde das aufgenommen? Wie durften Sie das?
Ich habe bereits bei der Diplomarbeit über DDR-Literatur geschrieben, in denen Selbstmorde vorkamen. Was ich heute weiß, ein Betreuer war Stasi-Mitglied. Er hat mich also observiert, hat mir aber alle Freiheiten gegeben. Es war ein kritisch denkender, sehr intelligenter Mensch. Also den ich hier meine, der war einer aus einer kleinen, primitiven Kleinstadt. An einer Universität, da wollte man etwas verändern. Und ich durfte dann die Diplomarbeit schon schreiben Und meine Dissertation habe ich über Juri Koch geschrieben, ein sorbischer Schriftsteller. Die Sorben waren eine Minderheit und lebten in einer Gegend, wo Braunkohle abgebaut wurde, wo die DDR ihre Rohstoffe hatte. Und das führte dazu, dass alle Dörfer zerstört wurden. Er hat also diese kritische Sache geschrieben und ich habe keinen Ärger damit bekommen. Ich gehörte nicht ganz zu den Staatsfeinden. Also wir haben telefoniert, ich hatte keinen eigenen Telefonanschluss. Also wenn ich an die Telefonzelle gegangen bin und ich seine Nummer gewählt habe, hat es immer Klick gemacht. Und die Briefe kamen auch etwas später. Aber er konnte veröffentlichen und ich habe über ihn geschrieben. Das war aber normal, weil, ich weiß auch nicht, in den 70er, 80er Jahren ging es eher als in den 60er Jahren. In den 60er Jahren wären wir eingestellt worden. Wir haben an der Universität auch vor allem diese Bücher gelesen, die das System kritisiert haben. Aber es stand ja immer zwischen den Zeilen. Man musste ein Gespür dafür haben. Aber das war interessant.
Können Sie noch ein bisschen darüber sprechen, so systemkritische Literatur, welche Werke und wie kamen Sie an die Öffentlichkeit, trotz der Kritik?
Ja, also systemkritische Literatur hat vor allem die Alltagsprobleme kritisiert. Niemand hat geschrieben, Honecker ist ein Idiot. Das ist, wozu? Das wussten wir ja. Das müsste man nicht schreiben. Sondern es ging ich habe also geschrieben über das Tragische, um den Konflikt zwischen individuellen Bedürfnissen und gesellschaftlichen Erfordernissen. Und da gab es sehr früh schon sehr gute Bücher. Erwin Strittmatter, Der Wundertäter, Band 3. Erik Neutsch, Spur der Steine. Christa Wolf, viele Bücher von Christa Wolf. Dann gab es Brigitte Reimann, recht unbekannt, aber eine interessante Frau. Sie schrieb auch über dieses Individuelle. Einen Uwe Johnson kannte ich nicht, weil er nicht mehr in der DDR erschienen ist. Die Verlage, der Aufbauverlag, bei dem dieses Buch erschienen ist, war der vom Schriftstellerverband empfohlene Verlag. Da konnten Autoren schreiben, die politisch so feststanden, wie Christa Wolf, dass man sie brauchte als Vorzeigebeispiel, wie gehen wir mit unseren Autoren um. Kleine Schriftsteller, die nicht so berühmt waren und notwendig, die haben in kleinen Verlagen veröffentlicht. Es gab sehr gute Gedichte. Das ist wie bei Heinrich Heine in seiner Zeit. Kurt Hager mochte keine Gedichte. Und die Zensur mochte keine Gedichte. Diese Metapher. Das hat man nicht verstanden. Wir haben sie verstanden. Kritische Gedichte war es leichter zu veröffentlichen. Kritische Bücher kamen in einer kleinen Auflage. Kuczynskis Buch 30.000. Das war relativ wenig. Und nur der interessierte Leser, der in der Zeitung das Negative verstanden hat, der ging in den Buchladen und der Buchhändler gab ihm das Buch. Der Normale, den hat das nicht interessiert. Ich habe gerade zu Juliane gesagt, Bildung war in der DDR wichtig, aber die am besten gebildetesten Menschen saßen in den politischen Funktionen und an den Universitäten. Das normale Volk guckte zur Westmark, guckte zu den Tropical Fruits, guckte zu den schicken Autos. Politik war egal. Und heute ist es genauso. Im Osten ist die Ansicht, die Politiker sind dumm, sie müssen abgesetzt werden. Wir wollen gut leben. Und das war in der DDR genauso.
Also die Länge, wenn ich Sie verstanden habe, die Länge der Werke hatte schon etwas mit der Zäsur zu tun.
Die Länge, nicht die Aufkürzung.
Ja,
Gedichte war was Besonderes. Gedichte war eben ein Bild. Und das musste man durchdenken. Und die gingen eher durch die Zensur.
Und wie ist es mit dieser Gattung, die in der DDR erschienen ist, diese Kurzprosa?
Ja.
Ist sie unter anderem vielleicht deshalb so populär geworden, weil man eben in der Kürze einiges sagen konnte, was nicht sonst veröffentlicht wird?
Nee. Die Bücher, die ich sagte, Strittmatter, Erik Neutsch,
ja.
Alles dicke Bücher.
Dicke Bücher.
Mhm. Ich habe in der DDR vor allem den Kurzroman gelesen. So dicke Bücher. Sie würden sagen, eine lange Novelle vielleicht. Und das war eigentlich die Sache des Dichters, was er am besten konnte. Also die Zensur hat dicke Bücher gelesen und auch dünne Bücher gelesen. Ein guter Autor ist noch Günther de Bruyne. Der hat auch, wir haben in der DDR sehr viel Geschichte in die Bücher gebracht. Christa Wolf hat ein tolles Buch geschrieben, wo es eigentlich um eine romantische Künstlerin geht. Die Probleme waren aber unsere. Und Günther de Bruyne hat auch die märkische Landschaft, Fontane, gelebt. Die Probleme, die er schrieb, waren unsere. Also ich habe einen sehr guten Deutschunterricht an einer sozialistischen Schule gehabt. Das lag an der guten Lehrerin.
Danke nochmals für den Vortrag. Können Sie noch mehr darüber sagen? Also Sie haben jetzt in der Deutschen Demokratischen Republik gelebt und in der Bundesrepublik Deutschland gelebt. Ja? Und was für eine Funktion hat die Literatur in diesen beiden Staaten? Weil für unsere Studenten heute wäre das vielleicht nicht so klar. Ich glaube, dass sie anders wäre, aber vielleicht könnten Sie das sagen.
Also, schwierig.
Ja, ist es die gleiche Funktion? Oder die Popularität, die Wichtigkeit, das Interesse für das Publikum und so weiter?
Das ist eine richtig gute Frage. Ich kann das nur aus der Sicht eines DDR-Menschen sehen. In der DDR haben wir uns über jedes neue Buch gefreut, was in dieser Zeitung schlecht gemacht wurde. Und wir haben Wochen gewartet und wussten genau, dieses Buch müssen wir jetzt lesen. Und mein halbes Bücherregal zu Hause ist voll von diesen Büchern. Übrigens auch russische Literatur. Rasputin, Bulgakov, auch diese kritischen russischen Bücher haben wir natürlich in Deutsch gelesen. Heute habe ich Millionen Bücher. Keine schlechten Zeitungsreviews. Und ich weiß gar nicht, was soll ich jetzt eigentlich lesen? Was sind die guten Bücher? Heute kann jeder in jedem Buch alles schreiben. Und das ist interessant. Die Schriftsteller, die heute noch leben und in der DDR kritische Schriftsteller waren, die finden das gar nicht schön, dass man heute alles schreiben kann. Weil ihr Buch ist eins unter Millionen. In der DDR war es eins und alle haben es gekauft. Viele dieser Schriftsteller, mein Freund Juri Koch, musste wieder arbeiten gehen. Er musste als Journalist wieder arbeiten, weil seine Bücher, ja, interessant, nicht so gekauft wurden. Ich mache das so, dass ich mich mit interessanten Menschen unterhalte und diese empfehlen mir gute Bücher. Aber ich lese heute gerne Bücher aus der Geschichte, weil ich vieles dort auch nicht kenne. Das ist schwierig.
Wie ist es mit dieser Vorlesung von Kuczynski aufgegangen, wo Sie die Stasi-Mitglieder dabei waren und trotzdem die kritischen Fragen gestellt wurden?
Einen Mann, der diese kritischen Fragen stellte, den kannte ich, das ist ein Lehrer an einer Highschool gewesen. Und ich habe ihn dann befragt und er hat gesagt, das wird in meiner Stasi-Akte stehen, aber ich bin weiter Lehrer. Es war schon zu weit fortgeschritten. Es wusste jeder, dass Honecker gehen musste. Sie war nur so naiv zu glauben, dass die Jungen, die nachkommen, besser sind. Und das waren sie nicht. Das war die Hoffnung, zu sagen, die Jungen, die ändern etwas. Aber Egon Krenz hätte nichts geändert. Es wäre auch nicht gegangen, denn der Westen, die Grenzen waren auf und man hätte nichts zurücknehmen können. Also ich lebe gerne in der Verdi. Das Phänomen ist, dass die Menschen, die in der DDR kritisch gedacht haben und an Universitäten gelehrt haben, gut gebildet waren, auch mit der Wende einen guten Job bekommen haben. Nicht in der Universität, dort hat man Kahlschlag gemacht, aber in der freien Wirtschaft. Sie waren ja gut ausgebildet. Und viele Menschen, die auf die Straße gegangen sind und gerufen haben, wir wollen die D-Mark, sind auch heute Menschen, die keine Arbeit haben, weil sie nicht so gut gebildet sind und weil sie nicht so engagiert sind. Und diese Menschen geben nicht sich die Schuld, sondern wieder dem System. Ich sage nur Pegida. Ja, das ist leider so.
Thank you. Maybe we pause here and allow those who would like to speak to my... Why do I speak English? to my mother. So if you would like to stick around and talk to my mother in person, you are most welcome to do so. I'd like to thank the German and Russian department for helping out with all of this. And thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And take a German class next time.